everyone. This is the Parks Academy, where we discuss and celebrate all things theme parks related. We focus mainly on Disney parks and resorts in both Anaheim and Orlando. My name is Paige.
My name is Steven.
And today we will be continuing our Park Icons miniseries.
Yes, we will. This one is really fun. One of the things that I am discovering about this miniseries is I look at each attraction or each sort of marquee thing, and I just say, this is not going to work. There's not that much information about it. And then I'm just pleasantly surprised.
Well, this one has a ton of information.
Yeah. Last time when we did Grizzly Peak, you went into it sort of blind because I put it all together. I came up with the ideas and stuff, and then I just basically rattled stuff off to you. But we did a little bit of like dual research together. So I think that's kind of fun because now you got a little more info.
Sure. Well, in this one, prior to the research we did, we've also learned a little bit of background about this one. So I kind of already had some knowledge going into this one.
That is right. So what's got you feeling excited? What's going on with you this week?
Our baseball teams are playing each other.
Sports every week. Yeah. They are. The Giants and the Orioles are playing each other. Today, Sunday, when we're recording, on the 4th, it's the rubber match, so we'll see who wins.
We'll see.
Yeah.
We'll see.
It's been fun to watch. The games have been crazy late because we're on the East Coast, so they start for us past 10 p.m.
Right.
And so I've been up till 1 in the morning watching them.
Right.
Which
today
is
an afternoon game, so that'll be better.
It's not unusual for me to stay up past 1 o'clock to watch a game. Especially because I'm a Bay Area sports fan, but it's always a little cumbersome to, you know, pull myself up to bed at like 1:30 in the morning.
Yeah, that's what I'm excited about this week, because prior to this season, it is like an every 4 years thing.
Mm-hmm.
And now that we have the balanced schedule,
yeah,
we can look forward to playing each other each year.
Yeah, the MLB made a bunch of changes this year. And one of those big ones was that every team basically plays each other twice a year. Somewhat, you know? So it's a lot less interleague play and more. Like,
you play everybody once.
Some of them you play twice, depending on, you know, where they are. But
sure.
Yeah, it's definitely a welcome change along with other things. So that is something for sure to be excited about. I am excited because on Friday morning, I took the day off of work and I drove up to Hershey Park and I rode Wildcat's Revenge. Their brand new hybrid steel roller coaster. It was good.
What were your thoughts?
My thoughts were that the roller coaster was great. So basically, Wildcat was an old wooden coaster in Hershey Park that was famously rickety and rough to ride. And while it was fun,
only roller coaster in my life that has ever given me whiplash.
Yeah, while it was fun, it was very difficult to ride. I rode it last year at some point by myself, and it was very, very rough on my back. This one, basically what they did was they took all of the bones of the wooden coaster and left them as is. And then they took a new steel coaster and built it on top of it, basically. So it looks crazy. It's a lot of fun. It has some inversions. It has like the world's longest and maybe first double inversion on a roller coaster. It's really, really good. It kind of acts like a wooden coaster when you're going up the hill. Like, you hear the creaking and the clicking. And then it feels like at some point it's going up and then it goes back a little bit and up and back a little bit. So it really kind of plays with your head as you're going on the ride. It was very fun, though.
I'm looking forward to being able to ride it.
You would like it a lot. It's really good. The
only
complaint that I would have is that I was really severely disappointed with the guest at Hershey Park, because, you know, at Disney, there's really no running allowed in the parks. Usually you get reprimanded by a cast member if you're running.
Sure.
And I got in an hour early because we're season pass holders. I got in, I went, you know, through the park, and there was an area where it was roped off with like these metal sort of gate system. And as soon as the gates opened up, people full on sprinted. I mean, I saw a couple people get knocked over. There was hoodlums in the garden beds trying to like get around everyone and run over them and stuff. It was because there was like a walkway with garden beds on each side, and there was people like climbing up into the garden beds trying to get over. It was a mess, and people are totally impatient. It's crazy.
Yeah, I have a feeling that that happens when pretty much most theme parks have like an opening day situation.
Yeah. No, I'm sure. I was just really surprised at how chaotic it was. And then I'm not really a runner, and I was not going to run, but I was, because I got there so early, I was like right in the front part of the line. I mean, I was like right in the front. And as soon as they opened, people took off, and I had like almost 150 people pass me in like 5 seconds. And so I thought, well, I probably should run. So I ran a little bit, and then it was just not great, but good ride, fun experience. I'm glad I got to go on it. Definitely a very, very good coaster.
Awesome.
For sure.
That's great.
Before we get started, I just wanted to quickly say, just as a little bit of front matter here, of course, we're sponsored by Deep Cut. You'll hear more about them later in the show, and we are linking to them in the show notes, but they're awesome. They make accessories and record displays for your music, and we really, really love these guys. Happy to have them sponsor us. And also, we just wanted to kind of get out of the way first really quick that we would really appreciate it if you guys would hit us with a nice review and maybe a rating on Apple Podcast. It definitely helps with some of the discoverability and credibility of the show. And we would just really appreciate any kind words you guys could give us. And of course, we'll read them on the show, share it with you guys. But yeah, those are pretty much the only front things I wanted to pull out. Do you have anything that you wanted to mention otherwise before we jump right into Tower of Terror?
I do not. That pretty much covers it.
Okay, well then, let's do it. Tonight's episode is somewhat unique and calls for a different kind of introduction. We are talking about the Twilight Zone Tower of Terror. Specifically for this Parks Icon series, we are going to be talking about the very first Tower of Terror, which is in Hollywood Studios. So, first things and first thoughts about the Tower of Terror before we get into the enormous amount of information that there is surrounding it. Tower of Terror was officially opened up at Disney's Hollywood Studios, or at the time MGM Studios, on July 22nd, 1994. It is a drop ride, and it is mixed with a lot of theatrical elements to it. That's basically for people who don't really know what it is, but I'm assuming if you're listening to this, you have a pretty good idea what Tower of Terror is.
Yes, and this is actually one of the only attractions. Is it the only attraction I've never ridden in Walt Disney World?
I think it might be. Besides ones like some maybe kiddie rides you've never been on before.
But in Walt Disney World, I've been on most of the kids' rides.
Mm-hmm.
So unless it came out in the last 2 years.
Yeah.
But even so, I think this is the only attraction I have never ridden.
Yeah. The only one that I was going to say you haven't been on in Walt Disney World is like, the one I'm thinking of is like Rise of the Resistance. But you've been on that one at Disneyland, or they're the same thing. So that's
right.
Sort of doesn't
Correct.
Count. So this beautiful ride, it was designed and inspired by a bunch of different Southern California landmarks, including the Biltmore Hotel and the Mission Inn. Its architectural style is referred to as something called Pueblo Deco, which is a combination of the Pueblo Revival and the Art Deco style. This tower is 199 feet tall and 11 inches, and it is actually the tallest attraction at Walt Disney World Resort. And it was specifically designed to be just under 200 feet to avoid having to put a red aircraft warning light on top of it, which, according to Imagineers, would completely detract from that 1930s aesthetic that they were going for.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know, just for fun. Well, actually, we'll get to that later. I was going to ask about other tall icons, but we're going to get to those ones in other episodes.
Sounds good.
I almost put the cart before the horse.
There you go.
So this ride is, what's interesting about this ride is Disney was really trying to get in on, at the time, figuring out like what they wanted to do with a drop ride attraction. There was a lot of different ideas going around. And, you know, as they were trying to put all of these sort of rough concepts together, originally, we'll talk about this one in just a second, but there was like a geyser ride that was floated around where you would basically be on top of a geyser and it would shoot you up in the sky, kind of similar to the ride mechanics, but a different storyline.
Okay.
And so they ended up kind of having all of these different ideas of like, what do we need to put at the end of Sunset Boulevard? So to back it up a little bit, during this period of time, Kevin Rafferty, who's an Imagineer, a brilliant Imagineer, mind you, he has a book called Magic Journey, My Fantastical Walt Disney Imagineering Career. This came out in 2019. Sadly, I believe he died in 2020. But Kevin Rafferty is a Imagineering genius and one that I don't think really gets enough credit. He actually, I'm going to read you off some of his resume.
Okay.
It's going to take a minute, okay? Mm-hmm. He is responsible for Typhoon Lagoon, the old Comedy Warehouse at Pleasure Island. He was responsible for the Star Tour show. He did the Tower of Terror. He did the 1994 remix of Carousel of Progress, It's Tough to Be a Bug, the Enchanted Tiki Room under new management. He wrote the music for Sunny Eclipse show. He did Blizzard Beach, Test Track, Rock and Roller Coaster, Mickey's Philhar Magic, Finding Nemo's Submarine Voyage, Toy Story Midway Mania. He was involved with Cars Land, and his final project he was involved with was Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railway.
Wow.
So this guy has a deep, deep resume
on
him.
Yes, absolutely.
He was one of the ones who was brought in to try to figure out this new ride mechanic that Michael Eisner and the rest of the team wanted, which was going to be a drop attraction. At the time, he was working on Roger Rabbit's Hollywood, which was going to be placed at the very far end of Sunset Boulevard, where Rock and Roller Coaster is now.
Mm-hmm.
The New York Times sort of described this as a kind of Toontown where you're in a movie and only cartoon characters live. A couple of the land, like key rides they were going to have in Roger Rabbit's Hollywood were the Toontown Transit and Baby Herman's Runaway Buggy Ride.
Mm-hmm.
With like babies smoking cigars and...
Oh, that sounds really Disney-like.
Well, you know Baby Herman.
Right.
So that project fell through, obviously. Mm-hmm. It was one that just completely fell apart. And at the same time, he was working on the ride Dick Tracy's Crime Stoppers. Have you heard of this?
No, I haven't.
So this ride was, it would have utilized the same kind of enhanced motion vehicle technology that we find in Indiana Jones and Dinosaur.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time, it was going to basically be in like an industrial warehouse as part of the 1920 Chicago era, and it was going to be built around this new area in Hollywood Studios proposed as Hollywoodland, which was kind of going to be like this old style of, you know, like Dick Tracy and 1920s Hollywood and all that.
Sure.
But the film, the Dick Tracy film that was kind of going to help propel this ride come to be, it performed horribly in the box office. Mm. So because it was so bad in the box office and no one cared about it, it was ultimately scrapped. I can't imagine it would have had long legs to it either, because part of it was that you were going to be riding around in cars with little guns and like shooting at bad guys.
Yeah.
And I just can't see how, I mean, that's Dick Tracy, but like, I just don't see how that would have ultimately been a success. So Kevin Rafferty, he had his hands full with these two projects at the same time as being handed over the reins to try and figure out what they were going to do with the Tower of Terror or what this new ride was going to be. He was also working on a ride that was going to go into Hollywood Studios as well, kind of in Sunset Boulevard, called the Creatures Choice Awards. This ride actually, it was more of a show than a ride. And the Creatures Choice Awards was basically a bunch of animatronic monsters. And there's no way on earth you're ever going to guess this, so I'm just going to tell you flat out. The host of this award show was going to be Eddie Frankenmurphy. And apparently, they were going to have Eddie Murphy, who had already agreed to the project and was in on it, record the voice. He was going to be a Frankenstein's monster, and he was going to be hosting this award show. And what's wild about this is the theater show would have the same, basically the same amount of animatronics that American Adventure had. So it would be this enormous scope of animatronics and award show monsters. There is not a lot of it, but there are some rough sketches of what Eddie Frankenmurphy would have looked like, what some of the monsters were going to look like. And all of this actually is in Kevin Rafferty's book, which I highly recommend you check out if you are interested in this kind of stuff at all. So as things go, he had already like three projects on his plate. And then this fourth one was thrust at him of trying to come up with this, you know, what is this new attraction going to be? There was talk about it being a drop ride. There was talk about it maybe being other things. They brought in a bunch of different kinds of collaborators. And interestingly, one of the first collaborators that they brought on to come up with sort of this scarier ride was Stephen King. The original idea for this ride when they brought in Stephen King, you're going to love this. You are going to love this. There was going to basically be, it was going to be like a ride through kind of thing. Okay. Through like Stephen King films and stuff, mm-hmm. which
no thanks.
I guess that Disney had Alien.
Right.
And so, you know, they could have handled something like this.
Was Alien still, I'm trying to think when the Alien ride, because
well,
that was only
to
open in the 80s, right?
Well, I'm not entirely sure the history of that, but I know the Stitch wasn't there because Stitch didn't come out in theaters until later.
Sure, so, sure. So, and we're talking 1994.
Well, yes, but this would have been earlier than 94 because this was all like planning phases.
Right.
So anyway, the point of...
Oh, so Alien actually didn't open until 1995.
Sure. So,
and then closed in 2003. So this timeline pretty much matches up with if they were like, yeah, we're making this Alien encounter thing.
Well...
Let's make something else scary.
So Stephen King essentially was in on it, but there was a lot of things going on with licensing and, you know, collaborative control and stuff like that, where, you know, he had all these giant ideas, but none of them just felt like they were going to fit into the parks. The big idea that King had was that you were going to have a fake loading area. And as you were in your car and you were in the loading area, the fake loading area, Pennywise was going to literally explode out of the control room. And that just ended up getting scrapped. However,
yep. That would have scared the bejeebies out of me.
He ended up taking some of his ideas and bringing them over to Universal, where he collaborated on other rides. And the whole, like, you know, explosion out of the control room is something that does happen in Revenge of the Mummy. In Orlando.
Yeah.
It doesn't happen in Hollywood, but you do get that in Orlando. So that was scrapped, ultimately. Then they brought in the famous film director and creator, Mel Brooks. And what Mel wanted to do was he wanted to kind of sell them the idea of a theme park. Well, first of all, he had to be sold on the idea of a theme park ride. Mm-hmm. So Mel didn't want anything to do with that, period. And the reason he was even brought in to begin with was because, you know, basically people told them, like, yeah, films have some kind of a value to them, of course. But the average person will probably watch a film once, two, three times, and then it'll kind of be in their mind, but they won't think about it all the time. Whereas they were basically saying, we can get hundreds of thousands of eyeballs in front of your properties. Every single day for at least 10 to 20 years, right? So that kind of perked up Mel's attention. And what he wanted to do was he wanted to create something called the Hotel Mel. And it was going to be kind of like a dark ride that took you through a backlot of what it was like to be on a movie set. And so this, of course, is where they sort of began to glean the idea for a hotel. And what he wanted to do was have it go through like the young Frankenstein castle eventually with gags and stuff like that from his film. But of course, that just sort of fell by the wayside as well. Again, licensing things, issues with just kind of making it happen and trying to figure out like what they wanted to do and how it was going to best serve the guest. They were also going to, at the end of Sunset Boulevard or somewhere in MGM, have the young Frankenstein castle sort of at the forced perspective off in the distance, which again, I just, that film is very good. It's very adult. And I don't know how it would have fit, you know.
Right. It would not have fit into the Disney vibe. Even though Hollywood Studios, formerly known as MGM, does and did have some elements that have had to become synonymous with Disney. Like Tower of Terror itself wasn't synonymous with Disney until, you know, it became this huge icon in that park. And then Disney ended up making the movie, The Tower of Terror. And so there were other things that sort of made it feel like Disney. Same with Haunted Mansion. Like, it wasn't already a thing, and then they made Haunted Mansion a big Disney thing. They made the movie and all of those aspects. So that's sort of what happened with Tower of Terror as well.
Yeah, exactly. And the other thing, too, is there's a lot of, like, to put it bluntly, sexual jokes and innuendos in Young Frankenstein. And so some of the humor would be lost on the kids, and it would probably be very limiting to them as far as their audience.
Right.
So basically, you've got a multitude of failed ideas, a ton of things that just aren't happening, including Roger Rabbit's Hollywood and Dick Tracy's Crime Stoppers. Like, all of these things are just kind of falling to pieces. But the idea of the hotel really sticks with them. And so they're thinking, okay, what can we do to try to get this hotel ride to actually be something? Like, what is it going to do? You know, what's it going to be? One of the very first ideas that was floated was that they liked the idea of the elevator. That was like a big thing that they wanted to do. And so they were trying to figure out, like, you know, what's going to be the plan with this? And how are we going to kind of have this falling elevator, you know, act up and be weird? Like, because you don't go just to a hotel and the elevator falls. That just doesn't happen.
Sure.
So they were thinking there has to be something kind of paranormal that's going to cause this to be a total catastrophe. And one of the first things that they pitched to Eisner was to kind of pull something from like a Vincent Price murder mystery, and that there was going to be a murder in the hotel pool, and the bad like omens and spirits from that murder caused the hotel to, you know, act up and to become kind of paranormal. And Eisner hated it. He's like, I don't want murder to be a part of the ride. It just doesn't feel right.
Yep.
And they were, you know, bouncing around all these ideas. And finally, as they were talking about it, they kind of came up with the idea of, you know, the Twilight Zone is a very popular TV show. There's a lot of kind of meat on that bone that we can pull from. Let's try to figure out something with that that'll work. Eventually, they were able to move forward with that idea because in the 90s, the Twilight Zone was becoming less relevant than it had been in the past. Let's just say that.
Sure.
Right? And Paramount is the owner and producer of the series. And the rights were cheap. And they were excited to sell their rights to Disney to have their IP be recognized for decades to come.
Yeah.
Certainly, I think that the popularity of the ride was going to be very understated, you know, because I do think in some ways it was a gamble. So with this ride, they had to come up with, you know, first of all, the mechanics of what it was going to do. The first thing that was kind of pushed out there was that Eisner wanted it to be a real hotel. And while in the behind the attraction miniseries on Disney Plus, they talk about how, well, you know, I mean, hotels are kind of more for sleeping and quiet and it wouldn't really match. Yes, that was part of it. But the other thing was that, you know, they were planning at the time of having like this separate area for the hotel, but the elevator ride would actually drop guests off directly in the lobby. So as you're checking into the hotel, literally to stay there, you hear screaming and people like hitting the floor, and then the doors opening and everyone getting off the ride, which would have been really fascinating, I think. But there was a lot of issues with capacity and ride mechanisms and like how the heck they were even going to make that happen to begin with.
Right. Because thinking through logistics of like, okay, then there has to be admission into the park from this door.
Right. And it's possible, which because they do that with DCA, Grand California.
Right. You know. But then there'd have to be like, you know, basically the equivalent of security at those doors. And then, you know, the people on the attraction, they'd have to make two separate lines because the people that are getting off that don't have to go back through security to get back in the park. So it just is, it gets a little murky when you put an attraction on the outskirts, unless the hotel is legitimately within the realm of the park and you'd have to check into your park or into your hotel by going into the park.
Right, right. And the funny thing too is that like Eisner was actually, he was not a stranger to quirky, weird hotel ideas. One of the things he really wanted to do kind of early on in his career too was in Riverside Drive in Burbank, one of the things he wanted to do was make a Mickey Mouse hotel. And people thought, like his team thought that it was going to be like a hotel named Mickey Mouse. What Eisner wanted to do was create an actual Mickey Mouse shaped hotel, like shaped hotel. Oh. So you could like live in his ears or his elbows or, you know, other places.
Weird.
Like his feet. And that ended up completely falling apart. So he had like all of these harebrained ideas of, you know, what exactly he wanted to do with hotels. And here's a quick fun jab. None of his ideas were crazier than charging $5,000 for two nights at a Star Wars hotel. Zing.
There it is.
Okay. So the ride mechanism. Obviously, this ride was going to be a free-falling style ride. So what Disney Imagineers did was they went to Connecticut, where the Otis Elevator Company resides. And they basically wanted help planning out the logistics of how are we going to do this. And so they had asked the team over at Otis that they wanted them to basically take them down as far as they could possibly go. And Otis was like, you're asking us to do the exact opposite of everything that we're, that's like asking an airplane to like fall out of the sky. Like, this is not what we do. And so Otis was like, okay, let's see how it goes. So a handful of Imagineers, some technicians, elevator technicians got in, they turned off the governor and just let it go as fast as it possibly could. And they got off and they were like, this needs to go faster. This is just not fast enough. We stood there normal. It was no big deal. So for those of you who may kind of know a little bit of the background of this ride, Disney essentially innovated and pioneered defying gravity in the hotel. So the way that it works is the ride system basically, you know, it combines, you know, traditional dark ride elements with a drop tower, and it pulls you down through like pulleys. So this is not advisable, but I've heard that if you have a penny in your hand and you ride the ride, the penny will float out of your hand because you're going faster than gravity itself. Don't do that.
Well, that's why people leave their seats.
Exactly. Like, correct.
Even with your lap belt, whatever it is. Right. I've never ridden the ride. I don't know if it's a strap or a bar.
It's a little strap. It's just a seatbelt.
So even with your seatbelt on, like your hair goes up, your butt leaves the seat.
Definitely.
So that shows you right there that it's anti-gravity.
So, I mean, it was a technical marvel for what Disney was trying to accomplish. I mean, riders are basically taken through a series of narrative scenes before taking their final drop. There is, you know, a whole lot going on in this ride to kind of pull off what they wanted to actually do. What I find really interesting about it, however, is so after this ride kind of came out and it was a huge hit and success with fans, it had to quickly be translated over to Disneyland, Tokyo Disney, or, you know, and then over to Disneyland Paris. The thing about the ride that's lacking in all the other parks is that, and this, like, shook me to my core when I first rode Tower of Terror in Hollywood Studios, there is no fifth dimension anywhere but in Orlando. So the part of the ride when you're brought up, you see the story, and you go up again, and then you basically go into the Twilight Zone, and you are on what was actually the first trackless ride system where you go through.
Mm-hmm.
That's only in Orlando.
Right.
And so...
they're the only ones with the space to do it.
Well, yes.
To start.
Yes, and there was actually a lot more downtime because the trackless ride system, especially in... You know, we always kind of thought, oh, yeah, the Winnie the Pooh ride in, I think, Tokyo or I think that's where it is. But, you know, Ratatouille and Galaxy's Edge and all these things are like the first big trackless ride systems. Well, like those are the first ones that take you on a bigger sort of journey at higher speeds. But it definitely wasn't the very first, you know, iteration of this traction. To go back a little bit in history. So Tony Baxter wanted to do the... Geyser Mountain. That was going to be going kind of where Galaxy's Edge is now, as like an expansion of Frontierland and Disneyland. They were planning it out. The idea of this ride was that you would enter through a reimagined Rainbow Cavern. It was kind of like a tribute to the classic mine train through Nature's Wonderland. And before the geyser shot your ride vehicle up the shaft, it was like cleverly disguised. As like, you know, the ride system was in a natural environment without a lot of technology. So it was like supposed to be a real surprise. So they were spearheading this idea. But the success of Tower of Terror had people in California basically saying, why don't we have that? And so they ended up through Sunset Boulevard or Hollywood Boulevard or whatever it's called in DCA. They ended up throwing it together there. And so because of that, they had less time, less resources. And they just had to put something together quick. So they sacrificed the fifth element in order to make the ride work. And they were able to do two things. First of all, it prevented a lot of downtime on the ride. So people, you know, were it's a lot faster to get on that one than it is in Orlando. And also they were able to, through the 13 stories, add in more ride vehicles. So I think there's like four instead of three.
Yeah.
Okay. What's interesting, though, is this is essentially the exact same thing that happened with Pirates of the Caribbean in Walt Disney World. So Walt Disney World was working on a huge expansion that was going to be coming a handful of years after Magic Kingdom opened, called the Western River Expedition. And it was going to be very Pirates-based, but kind of more of like the West. Because, you know, when people... So at the time in the 70s, people in Orlando weren't as familiar with like the Wild West. They didn't have as much like hands-on experience with like the Wild West.
Sure.
Whereas people in California didn't really have any hands-on experience unless you traveled a lot, especially in the 50s, with like the Bayou kind of pirates thing.
Right.
So Pirates of the Caribbean was so popular in California that when Disney World opened, fans were like, or guests were like, what the heck? Why don't we have this ride?
Yeah.
So that's why Pirates of the Caribbean and Magic Kingdom is shorter, mm-hmm. less interesting. Fewer drops because they didn't plan the park around building that ride to begin with.
Right.
Similarly, Tower of Terror in California is not as robust and exciting. I mean, it's still exciting, but it's a lot different because you don't have that fifth
Correct.
Element happening.
Yeah.
So the same thing, of course, with the ride in 2006. So in 2004, 10 years later, literally, it opened up in DCA. 2006, it was brought to Tokyo, and then in 2007, it was brought to Paris. The Tokyo version is a different kind of story about like a museum hotel owner who, you know, basically stole an artifact, and that's how that all happened because there was no, the Twilight Zone just wasn't really a part of Japanese culture, and they didn't really know it.
Right, and that's where they pulled in Joe Rohde, and...
Joe Rohde was the face of the main character. There's hundreds of him all over the building.
Yep.
Really funny bit about that in the Behind the Attraction
yes.
episodes. And then Paris wanted to have the original Tower of Terror, so they basically replicated it. But Disneyland, DCA, Tokyo, and Paris all have the same mechanism. Mm-hmm. Fifth element, the fifth sort of...
Dimension.
I keep saying fifth element.
It's okay.
You know?
We knew what you meant.
I know. So the fifth dimension is brought in only in Orlando. So again, like when I wrote it, I actually was trying to figure out, is this normal? Like, did I forget how the DCA one worked, or is this new? It was really an exciting experience for me. So, boy, that's a lot.
Yeah.
But we haven't even, like, got to the story yet.
I know.
You know?
I know.
So, the story is really just as big of a part as anything when it comes to Disney experiences. I told you, you know, kind of originally they wanted to do some kind of a Vincent Price, like murder in the hotel pool thing, and that was scrapped. And so we get over to the Twilight Zone. Perfect idea for this ride. And the ride story is basically fictitiously based off of something called what they call the Lost Episode, which is what the DJ McHale film that was released, I think, in 97 was based on with, you know, with Kirsten Dunst and who else was in that movie? Steve Guttenberg?
Kirsten Dunst is the only one that I remember.
So Kirsten Dunst and Steve Guttenberg were in that film.
Okay.
And basically, you know, they made that film in response to the ride. But Rod Sterling's introduction, which is what I tried to pull off at the beginning of this episode, is from a episode of The Twilight Zone called It's a Good Life. And this episode is about a boy who's named Anthony Fremont. He's like a six-year-old boy with like telekinesis, and he kills people and makes animals disappear and turns people into jack-in-the-box. It's a very unsettling, weird episode. But anyway, Rod Sterling's introduction is from that, where he says, you know, this story is, you know, different than anything a little bit different than what we've done before, whatever he says. And in the episode, he's actually in front of a U.S. map. And so obviously, since Sterling died in 1975, well before, you know, this ride even came to be, Imagineers had to green screen him out of the introduction scene in front of the U.S. map and put him in front of the elevator. And the introduction is quite literally identical up until when he says, you know, behind me, you will see a map of the United States. Yeah. But then in the ride, he says, behind me, you will see, you know, elevator doors or whatever. Mm-hmm. And they were able to get a guy named Mark Silverman, who took the rest of the dialogue and then created it, because he had like this insane ability to replicate Rod Sterling's voice like verbatim. Wow. So that was, I think that was pretty cool. And again, It's a Good Life, that movie, or that episode is partly what brought on, you know, the inspiration for the introduction.
Yeah.
The introduction was also, interestingly enough, directed by Joe Dante. So he did like the pre-show ride video that you see in the room. And he was the director not only of the original Twilight Zone movie, not the Tower of Terror movie, but the Twilight Zone film.
Sure.
And he also directed films like Gremlins 1 and 2, Inner Space, The Burbs, stuff like that.
Yeah.
So in the film, the Tower of Terror identifies five victims who are in the elevator, and then the lightning hits the building, causes this big like electromagnetic disruption. I don't really know what caused them to disappear, but lightning and magic, I guess.
Do you remember the movie? You've only seen it one time, and it was with me, right?
Yeah, I mean, I do, but I don't.
Well, the whole time you're trying to figure out like who's responsible for all.
Wasn't it because they were like all bad people?
It was because it was like basically jealousy of the little girl.
Right.
So wasn't it I forget.
Like her caretaker?
Is
I have
she
the
nanny or something?
So you had Sally Shine, right? Was the child star. Her nanny was Emmeline Partridge. There was Gilbert London, and his starlet lover, Carolyn Crossan, and finally a bellhop named Dewey Todd. Those were the five victims.
And the lady, the lover lady, isn't she from 17 again, the principal?
I don't know.
I think that's her.
So while the film is generally considered non-canonical, The names actually are used by both the fans and by Disney itself within the parks. So the people in the movie are the people in the ride. I feel like, you know, part of it had to do too with some of them were just all terrible in their own way. But I don't know, like, I don't know, like, what the little girl could have done besides just have like a, because she was inspired by Shirley Temple, who supposedly had a very difficult childhood. And I mean, child actors, I can't imagine, like, the film Judy talks about, like, Judy Garland's childhood and all these, like, crazy, you know, terrible things that happened to kids, especially in the old days in films, before there was, like, actually laws to protect children and movies and their rights and finances and stuff like that.
It was not the nanny. It makes you think it's the nanny the whole time because she thinks her nanny cursed her, but it was her sister.
Okay, I don't, it's been a while.
Yeah, I watched it with you a couple years ago because you had never seen it. But that's why I was misremembering, is because they think that it's the nanny, but it's actually the sister who, it was her birthday and everybody forgot about her birthday because they were making such a big deal about her sister and yada, yada, yada. She cursed it. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what happened.
Okay. So, Sally Shine's actress, Lindsay Ridgway, she portrayed both the girl in the introduction, like pre-show, directed by Joe Dante, and she also was in the film Tower of Terror itself. Like I said, she was visibly based on, you know, child actress Shirley Temple, who, you know, was born in 1928. And in the pre-show video, she's actually holding a plush Mickey Mouse, which I think is kind of kind of a fun little thing, you know? And so, yeah, I mean, you know, there's what's interesting to me about it is usually I feel like there's some kind of a lesson to be learned. But in this ride, I don't really think there's a lesson. It's just like, you know, maybe don't check in to old abandoned hotels would, you know, be the only thing I could possibly think of.
Yeah, I guess.
You know, like, don't wander in when there's cobwebs all over the place.
Yeah. And that's kind of like the warning that they give on several of the pre-shows, right? It's like, don't come here.
Yeah.
The one in Paris.
She says, like, I wouldn't go in there if I were you.
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
wagging her little Shirley Temple finger.
Right. It's like Paris and...
It's Paris.
Yeah.
Yeah. So...
Here's a quick fun side story.
Hit me with it.
The girl, I knew I remembered her, who plays Sally in the movie...
Yeah.
...is the replacement Morgan on Boy Meets World.
There you go.
So
cool.
Season 3-ish when Morgan randomly becomes a new actress. That's what she's from.
I hope she had a good upbringing.
I hope so.
Because, like, she's a child star too.
Yeah.
I was recently, I just finished up Succession because it literally just ended like last week on HBO. And Kieran Culkin, who, like, is incredible. Like, I think if he doesn't win an Emmy this year, I will just be very disappointed. He actually, in an interview, I think it might have been with Insider or someone, he was talking about how he, like, was so disinterested in acting because of the way Macaulay Culkin, his brother, was treated. And, you know, even now, like, as an actor, he just kind of sees through, like, all of the negativity of Hollywood and being in the limelight and how people can, like, treat you poorly and take advantage of you and stuff like that. So that definitely took a sad little turn because, you know, we're just talking about a ride, but also, you know, take care of kids when they're in films. I guess.
Child stars, protect them.
We're taking, it's official on the Parks Academy. We want to make sure child actors are treated properly, that their money is safe, and that they are safe.
There you go.
Bold, brave stance on the show, you know? So, yeah, I mean, that's, you know, so you've never ridden it. You've never ridden Mission Breakout.
Okay, I did
opened in 2017.
I did the queue of Mission Breakout.
Yeah.
As far as I could go.
You've only gone as far as the elevator on everything, and then you bail.
Correct. Yeah. And the Tower of Terror, same thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get to the point where you say, I'm not riding this. Take me downstairs.
And they get you in an elevator, and you're like, wait a minute.
One of the people in their costumes takes you on an elevator, and I looked at him, and I said, you promised me this is a regular elevator? And, you know, they stay in character and whatnot. But I was like, just please confirm. that you're being serious and that you can stay in character, but also please just don't be sassy with me and tell me that you're taking me down, not in drop fashion.
I'm going to get you on the ride. I think next time we go, I'm going to get you on that ride.
We'll see.
It's a lot of fun, and I think that you would enjoy it.
I think once our kids are old enough, if they want to do it, then I'll be brave.
They'll like shame mom.
I'll be brave.
I don't recall whether or not I wrote it by my for the first time when I went to Disney in 2000. Oh, you know what? It wasn't open when I went to Disney for the first time. Correct. It was 2002.
Yep.
So I didn't have to be afraid of it.
Yep, you do not.
Well, speaking of being afraid of the ride, one of the big differences between the MGM Hollywood Studios version and the California Adventure version was that all of them have a little bit of a different exterior look. And so the one in Hollywood Studios, when you're walking down Sunset Boulevard, you like see it. It's right there. And so the tower is the very first thing you see. And then like the ride is behind it.
Yes.
Right?
Yep.
Whereas in California Adventure, it's like the entrance to the hotel. There's like these lush gardens. Now, of course, it's something else. But it was like these lush gardens and this big entrance. And then the tower was behind it.
Correct.
So
it's like it's backwards.
Almost like this big looming kind of presence in Hollywood Studios. And so as you walk up to it, you're like, oh, that's really tall. And that's like really big and scary. And there's 13 floors of dropping.
Right.
You know? So that's an interesting difference. And it always kind of felt weird to me in DCA because it was just like there.
Right.
Although I guess it fit eventually, but it never had the legs to where it became the park's icon.
Sure.
Which I have to admit, I always kind of found it a little strange that Tower of Terror is the icon for
Hollywood
Studios.
Yeah.
I always kind of felt like it should have been Grauman's Chinese Theater.
Mm-hmm.
And then they had at one point the big Mickey hat, right?
So the Mickey hat was for a while. It was, yeah. Which I still have beef that that's gone.
That was one thing I really wanted to see when I went to Disney World for the first
time. It's such a bummer to not have it.
I went there and I was like, oh, I guess.
Well, they thought, remember we talked about this in a previous episode, there was some commentary about how it detracted from the Grauman's Chinese Theater and
then
they ended up doing, you know, light shows and nighttime spectaculars on the Chinese Theater, so that's kind of nice. But the association of Mickey's Sorcerer's Hat with Hollywood Studios is so great because that's where Fantasmic is, and so that was such a staple of that park that people went and then everybody went to Fantasmic to end their Hollywood Studios day. Like that was the big culminating thing. Well, and it just is such a bummer that got taken out of it, because then it made Fantasmic feel like such a less special thing that Hollywood Studios was doing. It made it feel like, okay, well, you know, that's just another show they have here.
I didn't even know that Fantasmic was there until later, because it just didn't make sense. Like, you know, it's in Disneyland, and I just didn't really associate it with being there. But the thing that's strange to me is that, and I guess that DCA is kind of the same way, but you've got almost every park, you know, 4 out of the 6 parks, the icon is like right in the middle. You walk in and like, there it is, right down Main Street. You know, you get to like Discovery Island and Animal Kingdom, and it's like right there at the Tree of Life, same with Spaceship Earth. But you have to like go into the park and then take a right to go see Tower of Terror. And even, I mean, you can still see it, obviously, because it's big and it like complements the Florida sky. And if you're at Epcot, you can like see it through Morocco, which I think is really cool.
Right, it matches the Morocco skyline, yep.
Which is amazing. But it's, I don't know, I feel like Grauman's is almost like, should be more of the icon, but it's not. So
I think the only reason it's not is because of its size.
Yeah, I think
it's purely the size of the Tower of Terror, that it just, you can see it from everywhere. And when you think about Walt Disney World, Spaceship Earth, Tree of Life, Cinderella's Castle, all towering over everything else.
Yep. And then,
what is towering over everything else in Hollywood Studios? It's Tower of Terror. That's
when
it.
When I made t-shirts for us, by the way, you can buy t-shirts online and you can get 20% off. Check our Instagram for the code. Like, you know, self-promotion. I actually set it up to where we had, you know, pretty much all the obvious icons. And for Disneyland, I made it be Matterhorn because that is pretty iconic, even though Sleeping Beauty's castle is the big one. But for Hollywood Studios, I like straight up made it the Millennium Falcon.
Yeah, why not?
Because, yeah, I just figured whatever.
Yep.
I'm going to wrap up our talk about Tower of Terror with some Easter eggs that I think that you might enjoy. So there is, in the lobby, a whole lot to look at. And if you're familiar at all with the Twilight Zone TV show, there's some things that you may recognize from this. And even if you're not familiar with the Twilight Zone TV show, there's actually a lot of things parodied from it in other in other television shows and stuff like that that's very familiar. In the lobby, there's a poster that advertises Anthony Fremont, who I mentioned was a six-year-old boy who had like the telekinesis. And it's actually his orchestra performing in the hotel's Tip Top Club. Fremont was the main antagonist in the episode It's a Good Life, where he was a very disturbed child with powers of a god. And he infamously like hated music with lyrics in it. And he was very weird about music to where it had to be very specific. And like, you know, if anyone interrupted, he would like turn them into a jack in the box and then like banish them to a cornfield. And so it's just kind of ironic that they have a poster for his orchestra there. On the directory, there are missing letters that spell out Evil Tower, You're Doomed. So if you fill in the blanks of the missing letters, that's what it says.
Yep.
in the library, you'll take a look and find a pair of broken glasses sitting on top of a stack of books. And the glasses are a reference to a very famous episode called Time Enough at Last, where a guy like, you know, has all the time in eternity to like read every book he wants and his glasses break, which is just poor fella. Mm-hmm. A couple of other ones are, if you see the Nick of the episode In the Nick of Time with William Shatner, there's a fortune teller machine that tormented Shatner, and that's in there. From the episode Caesar and Me, there is the ventriloquist dummy Caesar, who I think you would love. He's a very creepy looking ventriloquist.
I'm sure I would not.
He's very cute.
I hate dolls.
We love him.
We hate dolls.
There's an abandoned Mahjong set, which isn't really as much of an homage to an episode as much as it is like saying this hotel froze in time and everyone who was in here playing Mahjong, for instance, is just gone now. So there's a game that's in the middle of it. There is a 13 diamond AAA hotel plaque, which is, you know, funny because 13, uh-huh. You know, unlucky, yep. 13 floors, all that. And then finally, there is a very like dusty old trumpet from the episode Passage for Trumpet above some sheet music. And the sheet music that's underneath the trumpet is so random and so crazy. Are you ready for this? You ready for this?
I'm ready.
Okay. So in 1932, there was a song composed by Irving Caesar called No Mickey Mouse, What Kind of Party Is This?
Weird.
Yeah. and so those are the lyrics that are underneath the trumpet. And it is like, it's super weird and kind of random. There are no recordings of it, apparently. But the lyrics are so weird. I'm going to read you a little
by
bit
of them.
By
the title, I can imagine.
Should I try to like come up with a tune or just like read them?
Nope, I would just read them like a poem.
You don't want me to like try to sing it for you? when Noah planned his famous ark, he knew just what to do. He searched until he found a park and walked off with the zoo. With lions, tigers, monkeys, donkeys, he sailed the ocean wide. And when he lined them up on the deck, 'twas then some cuckoo cried. What? No, Mickey Mouse, what kind of party is this? Your lions roar, your tigers snore, I've heard them roar and snore before. I don't see why you make a fuss about the hippopotamus. Your dogs bow wow, your cats meow. I know that you can milk a cow, but Mickey makes me laugh and howl, and I want Mickey now. So, where's the tricky mouse? That slicky, wacky, wicky, blajvicky Mickey Mouse? Vote for Mickey Mouse. Let's make him our next president. To Congress, he is sure to say, meow, meow, okay, okay. Ha, ha, yes, see, see, wee, wee. How dry I am, have one on me. And then he'll cry, Give me the facts. Give me an axe. I'll cut your tax. He'll show us all what can be done when he's in Washington. So let's give the White House to Slicky Wacky Wicky Blashkovicky Mickey Mouse.
What in the world?
So it starts with Noah's Ark and then it ends with him like cutting taxes in Washington as our president.
Nice.
And I would vote for Mickey, I guess.
What year did that come out? What year was that written?
1932.
Okay. Interesting.
Yeah. So, you know, and of course, that was when FDR was president. So, yeah, I don't know.
What a weird little thing.
Yeah. So I don't know why that sheet music is in the lobby, but it's there. Yeah. And it has some of the weirdest, craziest lyrics.
I guess because of the timeline of like it's supposed to be 1930s Hollywood, but and it also mentions Mickey Mouse.
Yeah. I mean, I guess it kind of reminds me of like early 60s Beatles songs, if you know what I'm referencing.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Octopuses and submarines and whatnot.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, the Tower of Terror is really crazy. I think that there's a lot of fun with it. And one of the other things that I love so much is how it pulls from, you know, so many failed projects that are kind of like what ifs. You know, what if we had Dick Tracy's Crime Stoppers or the Creatures Choice Awards with Eddie, Frank, and Murphy?
I don't think any of those would have held up.
Yeah, it probably would have been a lot like Superstar Limo in DCA, where it was just like, what on earth?
Right.
But who knows? I would.
I know. We will never know.
I would love to see the Creatures Choice Awards, especially if it had like dozens and dozens of animatronics.
Right.
Could have been cool.
Yeah, weird.
Yeah.
Weird how many ideas were floated out there and just never came to fruition.
It's something else. The final thing that I want to say really quickly so we can just wrap this episode up. In a nice little package is, you may be wondering, you know, this is all good and great. I don't want to go on Tower of Terror because I might fall to my death. There's a YouTube channel called The Art of Engineering, and they basically go through like all of the show scenes and Pepper's ghost effects, you know, force perspective and all that, kind of talking about the ride mechanics. But they do talk about the fail safes in the ride. And how, you know, there are brakes and then there are speed governors that kick into place if the brakes fail. And there's a governing system and the counterweights. And if both the cables snap, it would activate an emergency brake. If everything failed all at once, which is like statistically near impossible, the falling elevator would create a cushion of compressed air at the bottom of it that would help, you know, break the fall. And there's shock absorbers at the bottom. So essentially, like it would be like if you're mid-fall and it breaks, like you're just going to stop.
Unless a jealous little sister or jealous older sister curses you. That's the only chance of dying on this ride.
All right, everyone. Well, that is going to do it for us. We just want to say thank you so much for joining us on this super fun series. We are going to be jumping into our next couple of episodes are going to be Spaceship Earth and the Tree of Life. And we are going to save the castles for last. We just want to say thanks again so much for listening to the show. You can find us online at theparksacademypod.com, on Instagram at theparksacademy. Thank you again so much to Deep Cut for sponsoring the show. You can get 10% off your first order of record accessories or record display shelves using the code TPA10 at checkout. We highly recommend you check these guys out and take advantage of that offer. Remember to check us out, you know, online, rate, review the show on Apple Podcasts. And until then, start in Canada, start in Adventureland.